my honor to introduce Professor Richard Epstein for our keynote speech. Professor Richard Epstein is the inaugural Lawrence A. Tisch Professor of Law at NYU Law. Prior to joining the faculty, he was a visiting professor from 2007 through 2009, when he was the James Parker Hall Distinguished Service Professor of Law at the University of Chicago. Epstein has served as the Peter and Kristen Bedford Senior Fellow at the Hoover Institution since 2000. His initial law school appointment was at the University of Southern California from 1968 to 1972. Professor Epstein received an LLD HC from the University of Ghent in 2003. He has been a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences since 1985 and has been a senior fellow of the Center for Clinical Medical Ethics at the University of Chicago Medical School, also since 1983. He has served as editor of the Journal of Legal Studies from 1981 to 1991 and of the Journal of Law and Economics from 1991 to 2001. From 2001 to 2010, he was the director of the John M. Olin Program in Law and Economics at the University of Chicago. Some of Professor Epstein's recent books include The Case Against Employee Free Choice Act, Supreme Neglect, How to Revive the Constitutional Protection of Property Rights, Antitrust Decrees in Theory and Practice, Why Less is More, Overdose, How Excessive Government Regulation Stifles Pharmaceutical Innovation, How Progressives Rewrote the Constitution, Cases, Materials
enough,
on Torts.
Enough.
Okay. He's presently working on books dealing with private property and the rule of law, as well as classical liberal constitutionalism. He's written numerous articles on a wide range of legal and interdisciplinary subjects. He's taught courses in administrative law, antitrust law, civil procedure, communications, constitutional law, and a whole bunch more. He also writes a weekly column for Forbes.com.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor.
I'm going to come over here. Each aside, and now, if I shut this thing down, will that shut that thing down?
I don't think so.
It's always a painful situation to be hidden behind a laptop. For all I know, I may be surfing the net while giving my own lecture, but I think that's the first that I'm not going to try to attempt. But it's a very great honor to be here, and it's a very great honor to follow after the two panels this morning. And just by way of an initial observation before I get to my own speech, there really seems to be a genuine change in intellectual mood that comes to the question of linguistic interpretation, both inside and outside the legal arena. When I started teaching 40-odd years ago, there was much more sort of virulent skepticism about the way in which things were to work. And the typical mode of argument that you heard is somebody would come up with a complicated case that dealt with a question like proximate cause or assumption of risk, throw up their hands when they couldn't solve it, and then conclude, therefore, that the entire linguistic structure and the edifice of the law was not really worth preserving because we could not handle this, that, or the other case. And I think that the most commendable feature of the discourse that we had on both panels this morning is that people understood that marginal cases there will always be, that the marginal cases are likely to have a higher probability of making their way up to appellate jurisdictions precisely because they are difficult, but that what you really want to do when you start your analysis of language is to start with language on the ground. And the single most important thing that you have to do, which you are doing right now, is why is it that we are so successful in communicating such a large fraction of the time? What are the particular devices that we use in order to secure that communication? And then once we figured out what the method is, the purpose of a legal analysis of the hermeneutical tradition in which I was born and which I still practice, I'm something of a freak on that score, is essentially to try to take these ordinary intuitions, the plain meaning approach, whatever you wish to call it, and then to try to figure out, starting with that particular approach, how is it that when you get to these difficult cases, you could clear away some conceptual misconceptions and confusions and so forth and make the thing a little bit clearer than it was. It turns out in order to do that, it's actually a much more ambitious task than you many times would think, because a lot of the stuff when you come to deal with the questions of explication require you necessarily to go back and make explicit the implicit normative framework under which the ordinary language starts to work. We know, ironically, when you look at the various bodies of literature dealing with evolutionary psychology and the like, that it turns out that there's much more commonality in the way in which people think and the way in which language is organized, based in large part on the imperatives that we have with respect to the way in which social life is organized. You must be able to eat, you must be able to procreate, you must be able to raise children, you must be able to defend yourself, and so forth. And so if you go back to sort of the classical thinkers, who started from the brute fact of sort of self-preservation as the precondition of all kinds of civil society, and then try to figure out what kind of normative structure grows up around that, you can see a very close correlation between the way in which people think descriptively and the way in which they think normatively. For these purposes, I'm not going to start with the political theory side of this issue. Rather, what I'm going to do is to start with the descriptive side and try to figure out what it is that we're talking about when we talk about language. And essentially, the basic problem that we have in language is the following. We are trying to convey information, and we would like this information to be, shall we say, reliable, such that if you spelled out everything, the person on the other end of the communication would make no mistake about the way in which you are going to behave and what you expect them to do. What you discover, however, is that there's a trade-off that comes with respect to the way in which ordinary language is organized, because if what you do is you spend a huge amount of time and take a great deal of effort to make specific all of the rules and all of the exceptions and all of the contingencies and all the things that you want, you never really finish the conversation. And so what happens is you can lose more by way of delay than you could lose by way of, shall we say, precision that you could gain. And after a while, what people start to do is they say, like in every other kind of intelligent activities in which people undertake, there is always going to be a set of marginal conditions that have to be satisfied. And so what you do is you ask yourself whether or not the costs that you incur in trying to get these greater levels of specificity generate a benefit which is of equal or greater amount. And what you can do to see why it is that language starts to have, in its usual way, certain kinds of ellipses and shortcuts is just to make the following calculation. Assume that what we did is we started with every utterance as being a perfect contingent state question or proposition, such that you articulated all the background assumptions that you made, and anybody who's listening to you could figure out exactly going forward what you're supposed to do and under any and all circumstances which take place. Well, you'd never get it finished, and you'd be spending a lot of time worrying about low probability circumstances which are not likely to arise. And so what people immediately start to do is they say, fine, I'm willing to degrade the system or the signal a little bit in order to get much more information across rapidly. So the question then comes, where are you willing to degrade the signal and why? And one of the things which we didn't stress in this conversation this morning, but which certainly relates to the problem at hand, is that in some cases when you start to degrade the signal and you make mistakes, the consequences of an error associated with the degradation are relatively small. And so, you know, you're sitting there and you're talking and you get a little bit of a hurry, and I'm kind of a guy who does this, and I say, peace past the salt, and I mean the pepper, and I'm kind of worried. You know, it's not the end of the world, and then when I get the salt and I look at it, I meant the pepper. And it's not as though salt means pepper by virtue of that equation. It's just that there was a slip of the tongue which is easily remediable. Now, in effect, when you're sitting in a surgical operating room and the question is past the scalpel or past the bandage and somebody starts giving you the wrong thing, somebody could bleed to death inside the circumstances. Or if you're being somebody who's running an airplane and you have to follow precise commands, all of a sudden the error costs are very much higher. And so what you start to see is all sorts of institutional arrangements that grow up, which push you right back to the formal side of the operation. And so, for example, air controllers only speak in English and they only use very defined codes, because the moment you give one kind of mistake in that kind of a translation, you can easily crash a plane one into another. And in fact, one of the things that we discover is that if you look back to some of the most serious airplane collisions that have ever taken place, it's because there was somebody who used a casual expression instead of a precise one, which was misunderstood on the other side, and two planes start to crash on the same runway. That's exactly, for example, what happened to the Tenerife collision that took place 15 or 18 years ago. And so what you see is when you get to high-stakes type situations, people don't rely on ordinary language. They have all sorts of other rules that are going to be used in order to back up the kind of situation so as to deal with a lower level of error and to do so with a greater degree of assurance. Well, once we know this, the law kind of fits very uneasily into this particular paradigm, because there is no question that this is a kind of system when you start to give decrees upon which the application of public force can take place, where in fact these things may have very large consequences associated with them. And so then the question you have to face there is, how are you going to move on the scale of formality from the casual on the one hand to the sort of absolutely precise on the other? And you discover that there are all sorts of constraints in the effort to try to move yourself sharply into the place that you can when you're trading, for example, on the stockroom floor. And what you see, in effect, is a kind of very difficult sorts of compromises. And let me tell you how I think they come out. What happens is, and I think several people have used this phrase, is when you're dealing with constitutions or with ancient statutes, you're dealing with things that are written in stone. And when you write something in stone, what you're saying in effect is that it's extremely difficult to correct what is written because you have to chisel out something that is already in place. And at the same time, particularly in earlier societies, which makes this issue extremely acute, you don't have a very big stone tablet on which to write the particular thing in question. The Ten Commandments, last I look, is shorter than the most recent statute passed by Congress by a factor of 1,000. And the same thing is true when you start looking at the Roman situations. So the issue is then how you manage to construe fundamental commands of great importance, like thou shalt not kill, which we talked about, or Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech, where brevity is the soul of wit in one sense and an invitation to disaster in another. And I think in many ways the philosopher whom I resonate most with on this is, I think it was a Christian philosopher, it was C.S. Lewis, not C.I. Lewis, if I'm getting it right. And he's trying to figure out how it is that you develop a system of moral realism. And essentially what he did so was to kind of use the dialogic method, watching the way in which people would interact with one another in all sorts of casual situations. And parent and children situations are extremely instructive, this part, because the parent, to some extent, is the lawgiver and the administrator all combined into one, whereas the child, in fact, is the person who is going to be subject to the command. And so what you do is you start seeing the way in which these discourses take place. Johnny, I told you not to hit Charlie. And the kid looks at them, and he says, Mom, I didn't hit Charlie, I kicked. And the question you're supposed to do is to figure out whether or not that gets you outside of the scope of the moral prohibition. Now, one of the things that Mom can do is, he says, Charlie, I told you that the direct application of force by your person or property against Charlie is something which is utterly immaterial and inappropriate under the circumstances. Now the kid doesn't understand what is being told to him. So you have this dilemma. And what you see, in effect, is a kind of a game theoretical type situation where you give a command in ordinary language, and what happens is Charlie plays, or Johnny, whatever the name is, your kid plays the dame of the dumb literalist. And you can keep these up. So he says, I told you not to hit this kid. He said, I didn't hit him. What I did is I poked him with a stick. And it's exactly the same kind of situation. And so what you do as a kind of a casuist is you listen to the way in these particular situations take place, and you start to develop what is sometimes called, at least by me, I call it the anti-circumvention norm, is that what you develop in ordinary language from a plain meaning perspective is the notion that if you understand the nature of the core command that is being directed, what you will then do is to say that it covers all of the close substitutes that your wretched child can engage in order to defeat the command that you have, i.e. to escape the sanction of the law and to achieve absolutely and properly all the things that he wanted to do. And all you need to do is to have a modest assertion about juvenile self-interest, people who love the gains of illicit activities but don't want to pay the punishment, and you can see a conversation like that taking place hundreds and thousands of times. And what I've just given you thus far is the kinds of evasions that start to take place where it's one mode of force that is applied as opposed to another. And the reason you all laugh is the reason that Wittgenstein gave is you understand that I'm sort of creating a serious violation with ordinary understandings when I raise the kind of defense because everybody's moral intuitions are done that way. Well, it turns out when you're going back to the tort law, it's not just the direct application of force, which is in fact the subject of all our anxiety and our wrath, we also have what you would call loosely the cases of indirect causation. So now Johnny fully internalizes what it means to apply force in all of its modalities and is determined to kill you without doing that, so he thinks of another bunch of situations. He builds a bunch of traps so that when you walk down the street, instead of putting your face on a firm thing, you fall into a hole and you're eaten by some snake below. Or instead of forcing poison down your throat, he simply mixes it into your various drinks and potions, and sure enough, when you drink it, you turn out to die. And the same question arises before. Do we, when we start having the command that you shall not kill another individual, only cover direct application of force cases, or do we try to cover all of these indirect cases? And it may be a surprise to people as to how difficult it is for legal systems to jump that particular barrier, from the simple transitive verb, he hit me, to the I created a trap or a dangerous condition. But I think I could report with complete confidence there is not a single legal system that ultimately has not made that particular situation. In some cases, it's actually very difficult to do Textually, because if you go back to the Roman text on what it means to kill somebody, they use the word occidere, and that means to kill by cutting. And so what you have to do now is to say, I can't bring this within the statute. And what every legal system does when they find that literalism leads to the wrong result is they develop the rule of similar cases, saying, in effect, if you have a prohibition that applies to this, we will find those things that fall outside the basic area, which we will treat in exactly the same way. And these are called, under various terms, in the Latin, it was the actio utilis or the actio in factum, which means these are utilitarian actions or actions that depend upon the facts and circumstances of the cases, kind of rough translations. And the English, developing this fairly differently, they call it the action summum cas, or the action upon my case, or the equitable actions. They're using exactly the same kind of notions. And what happens is when we start talking about a plain meaning theory, everybody who does this really slips in from plain meaning, what do we mean by the word cut, to a theory of ordinary understandings, which is designed to cover these other things. And what we discover, in effect, is that we're not just interested in semantic meaning of what it means to cut. We're interested in finding out a general theory which will tell us what things are sufficiently close by way of analogy that we will treat them in the same fashion. Now, the obvious mistake or difficulty you're going to get with this theory is going to be as follows. All right, Professor Epstein, you told us that we can start talking about similar cases and analogous actions and so forth, but everybody knows that an analogy turns out to be within the scope of the beholder, and that what you've done in order to cure this one little defect is you've created an anti-circumvention norm which is so grief that we can stop everything. And again, the casuists were well aware of this particular countermove, and they also took very powerful steps in order to deal with it. And this is the thing that you have to do under these circumstances. You must find a case which essentially is a plausible rendition of why you'd want to bring it in there where it's wrong. That is, you have to find cases where if you're going to use the similar case rationale, you're still going to reject the claim that it's going to be covered. And if you go back to the situations I was talking about force, and I was talking about deception, traps, and things of that sort. And the case which becomes extremely important when you start getting to modern times is whether or not you've done exactly the same thing by quote-unquote harming somebody, which is now the new umbrella category, as opposed to cutting into poisoning them, where when you go into business, you sell identical wares as your competitor at a price lower than theirs, such that you have now driven them out of business. And the issue as to whether or not this form of predation is in fact a form of ruinous competition, which should be treated like the cutting cases and so forth. Now you think about this in an ordinary context, and everybody instantly understands the difference between these two things, that one of them involves force and its variance, and the other involves ordinary market behavior, and if we go this far, the entire game is going to be over. But it turns out it's extremely difficult to develop, if you just look at the A upon B type analogies, the explanation as to why it is that the two cases are so fundamentally different. And so this is where the theorist has to take over from the casuist to try to explain what it is. And the best and most powerful explanation is if you look at all those cases in which force or its analogous type situations are used against another individual, you're pretty confident that the private losses as between the two parties are not offset by any public losses created in anybody else. So already you're now introducing a kind of explicit consequentialist framework which was not part of the original discourse. On the other hand, when you start looking at the cases where somebody starts talking about the fact that competition drove them out of business, if you go back to the normative theory, generally speaking, competition, if you understand the way in which it works, creates a kind of social optimum. So if you have private actions that cause individual harms that lead you to a social optimum, you ought to treat it one way. If you have private actions that lead to the degradation of society by violence and strife, you ought to treat it another. And so the proposition that we ought to treat competitive harm as though it's physical harm is basically a proposition that competition and anarchy are exactly the same thing and ought to be treated in exactly the same way and be subject to government situations or control. It turns out, of course, that argument has won in the United States in many cases, because if you start to look at the way in which the Progressive Revolution took place in the 1930s and so forth, virtually every one of the major statutes that were designed to prop up incumbents were done so on the theory that ruinous economic competition was harmful. Now fill in the blank. Is it to labor unions? Is it to the dairy industry? Is it to the wheat farmers? And so forth. So that the game of analogies, if played incorrectly, leads to absolutely momentous transformations. If it's played correctly, what it tends to lead to is a relatively circumscribed type situation. And essentially what you have to do to understand how ordinary language works, sooner or later, is to build into that ordinary language the underlying normative theory, which essentially has to do with the consequences that the various kinds of actions have for various people. Now, going back to the original point of this discussion, what we were doing, in effect, by way of the ordinary language, was trying to figure out how it is that we expend a particular term and meaning to deal with analogous cases. And this is a way of trying to place things into some time of a consequence, some sort of context, in which we're not dealing with an exact equivalent, but which is something close enough that we can deal with. Context, of course, is not only concerned about analogies, it's also concerned about justifications and background settings for which particular actions start to take place. So if you just confine yourself to the cases where we know that there's something wrong, i.e. the cases of poisoning and killing and so forth, you ask yourself whether or not anybody who engages in these kinds of activities is necessarily committed some kind of a wrong. And it's at that point we have exactly the kind of dialogue that takes place in private law that Scott and I had this morning, talking about what do you mean by freedom of speech under the First Amendment. What are the sets of justifications that people can introduce? And now, first of all, in order to understand the logic of this, it's useful, I think, to put it into context and to stress two words and then to show you how it is that they interact. The first of these words, which is one which is used all the time by our legal system, is the word presumption or the phrase prima facie case. And then the second set of terms, which are used all the time in ordinary language, is in fact the term justification or excuse. And the question is, therefore, how it is can you organize these particular intuitions and make them into some part of a coherent theory? And this is the way, I think, in which it is done. Every single cause of action that one would want to talk about is, in fact, talked about in terms of a prima facie case. All of you lawyers understand this because you know that any prima facie case is subject to an affirmative defense which can be raised by the defendant. And so then the question is how these various things start to fit together. Logically, this is basically a mathematical strategy that we followed in ordinary language, and it's an extremely clever one. I don't know how many of you have actually spent some time working with mathematics, but essentially, when you get a new mathematical problem, one of the things that you try to do is to solve it by way of successive approximations so that you can make it look like a familiar problem, which you've never seen before. So if you go back to the Greeks, it turns out they introduced one little constant known as pi, which is the ratio of a circumference to a diameter, and then the way in which they find out the area of a circle is what they do is they embed in that particular circle a series of linear objects for which you can find the area by traditional techniques, and then what you do is you push them to the limit, and when you sum them, it turns out that you can now find a way through successive approximations and further refinements to get yourself from a world in which you have only linear objects associated with areas where essentially height times width is going to be perfectly enough to solve every single problem with one variation to the far more powerful situation where you can start to use curves. And the reason why pi always comes up in just about anything you do is that's the one constant you need to know in order to create the linkage between the linear world on the one hand and the curvilinear world on the other. And that's, of course, is an extremely important thing. Well, presumptions in law actually work more or less in the same way. What you say, in effect, is we have now staked out a position that to kill somebody or to maim somebody or to use the world of contract, not to perform a promise that you make somebody, is on balance the kind of activity which we regard as regrettable from a long-term social consequence. And the way in which we know that is we say, well, let's just create another prima facie case and then figure out what kinds of defenses we're going to do it. And the prima facie case is I smiled at Hannah. And we're not talking about sexual harassment or anything fancy like that. It's just I said good morning. And how do you justify that? And basically the answer that most people have is you do not have to justify that which is not a wrong unto other individuals. Those are simply exercises of what we now come to call ordinary liberties. So the justifications, in effect, presuppose the prima facie wrong, and what they're trying to do is to say there are a set of cases in which even though the consequences are normally or ordinarily bad from certain kinds of conduct, in these particular cases, things start to flip over. And so when you start having, for example, a deliberate harm which is inflicted when there's the consent of the victim, you start to say, well, we can't possibly use the old rules with respect to that. Do we really want to say that every time a surgeon deliberately cuts a patient, he's going to be liable in tort, notwithstanding the fact that there's been full consent for the operation in question? And the answer that every sane system comes up with, without exception, there's no variation on this point, is that consent is, in fact, a defense against the basic infliction of harm. And the same thing can be done with respect to self-defense. But it's at this particular point that you now see where the casuistic approach starts to work really well. If you look at modern pleading systems and they're faced with this kind of problem, what most of them tend to say is we give the plaintiff a chance to say his piece and we give the defendant the chance to say her piece, and then having heard both sides say things, we'll make a judgment. This is absolutely an anathema to the good casuistic lawyer. Because what happens is they're working under a completely different kind of concept, which goes back to the philosophical, much misunderstood tradition of defeasibility, which, of course, you've got to work with a lot of times, Scott, right? And what you're saying with defeasibility is, this is a prima facie case, and I can defeat it by showing self-defense. And then somebody's going to come up, well, I mean, I know I hit him in defense, but instead of just pushing him away, I decided to kill him. And then you will have a debate as to whether or not excessive force is an exception to of the self-defense kind of plea. And as you keep on introducing more and more complications, what happens is you decide which of these things to admit within the systems and which of them to exclude. And if you really know how to do this thing, essentially what you can do is make an elaborate decision tree in which first the prima facie case, then the defenses, then the replications as they were called in Roman law, then the rejoinders to those things and so forth. This is not a new idea. If you go back and you read Gaius writing in about 161 AD, he has a perfectly coherent explanation as to what the process is like, and in fact, a perfectly good explanation as to why they do it. And even better than that, if you go through other portions of the book, you can see the thing being applied in a masterful fashion by the Romans, who were terrific casuists, even though for the most part, they were not deep theoretical types, who would explain how it is that all of this elaborate procedure would lead you slowly to converge on what I would like to call a social optimum by following all of these rules. So essentially, if you're now starting to talk about simply ordinary language and the modes of interpretation that are associated with its operation, it turns out that this ordinary language system is rather more complicated than it might seem at first blush, because you're clearly not talking just about the meaning of particular terms in a dictionary sense. What you're talking about is the functionality associated with this and the basic intuitions that people have, and I think they're correct, is that when we start saying it's wrong to hit somebody else, we don't only mean that as a literal statement about punching. What we mean to do by that particular statement is to import the entire interpretive structure of which this is a part, and that becomes the framework in which our ordinary discourse starts to take place. What happens is that as the cases start to become more complicated on the facts, generally speaking, people cannot quite figure out where it is going, and so there's a tendency, particularly in ordinary language, to try when you get to the more complex and low probability variances or variations to cheat on the way in which the system looks. And the way in which that is done, and it's a term which I did not recall being used once this morning, is we start introducing notions of reasonableness in order to figure out what the complications are. And reasonableness is just the signal saying, we know in effect that you've got self-defense, we know it's subject to qualifications, we can't really spell out what they are here, so we know that reasonable self-defense is only the use of force which is reasonable under the circumstances, and that's not an answer to what the question is, it's simply an invitation for somebody to dig harder and figure out exactly what the relevant elements are and how they ought to be put into the equation. So when I say in effect that you're dealing with this ordinary language type situation, that you are mainly right and mainly instructive, what I mean in effect is that if you put the whole thing together, it's going to really transform the way in which you start to think about things. And in fact, what I talked about mainly on the tort side can be carried over with equal force to the contract side. For those of you who started to work in the law of restitution, it turns out that it applies there, although the number of variations turn out to be relatively smaller and so forth. So by the time you're done, what the traditional systems of exegesis did is they started with essentially a point, and what they did is they built an entire system upon it. Now, let me just, I don't know how much more time I have, but suppose I were to just take a few more minutes, let me show you how it is that this kind of system, in effect, explains what most modern American constitutional law is about, leaving aside for the end just a couple of sentences about how you deal with administrative statutes. If you look at the American Constitution, there's the following interesting contrast between the evolution of its history on the one hand and the evolution of the doctrine that we tend to organize it with on the other. The 19th century is probably the beginning of the first organized treatises on American constitutional law. And the three of them, which take place in the post-Civil War period, were written by very able men, Thomas Cooley, Christian von, whatever his name, von Tiedemann, and Ernst Freund of the University of Chicago. And all of these books about the Constitution, in effect, have the words police power in their title. And the basic task that they're trying to do is to figure out how it is that you understand the role of the police power in American constitutional interpretation. This cannot be regarded in any sane way as a sort of a plain meaning interpretation, i.e. looking at the particular words of the Constitution and understanding them in context, because the words police power are nowhere in the Constitution at all. And yet they are the dominant interpretive motif long before people started to develop any of the paradigms associated with originalism or the various kinds of living constitutional alternatives. And the question is how it is that you manage to get this into the Constitution and to do it in a way which is interpretively legitimate by following the techniques that I've talked about. And that, I think, is exactly the way in which constitutional studies are working. If you recall what I said about the sort of the ordinary language approaches that we have with respect to these simple propositions about not hitting and so forth, in the end, what you have to do in order to make them go is to uncover an implicit normative theory about the sorts of things that one person is entitled to do to another, so that you can draw the distinction between competitive harms, which are normally what the Romans quite accurately used to call damn them absquare injuria, harm that was suffered but not harm that was regarded as unlawful, and what the modern economists call something which is completely unhelpful, known as the pecuniary externality, that is a loss to somebody else measured in dollars, which is not like pollution, for which no recovery is therefore going to be allowed. And the police power is the way in which we do this. So this is what happens. Let's just start with the First Amendment, but you could take any of the clauses, like the Fifth or the Fourth, and come up with exactly the same argument. Somebody says, look, Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech. Now, our friend Newborn this morning, I think, well, he's not here today, but he got us off on the wrong track by saying that Congress only refers to the Congress and it doesn't refer to the president or it doesn't refer to the court. I don't think that's actually particularly important for the following reason, is the executive can only exercise those powers that are given unto him by the Congress. If the Congress has, in fact, authorized activities that are illegal when the executive does it, you're saying Congress made a law to which he applied. And if the executive is going out on his own hook without any authorization whatsoever, he's simply illegal because he's no longer active within the confines of the office. So I think the guys who drafted it actually had a pretty good sense as to why it is they were after the lawmaking power under these circumstances, because the structural provisions of the rest of the Constitution will take after it. But when you get to the other words, shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech, now the question is, how do you explicate that? And the correct point here, and this is one that I think Bert was closer to the mark on, the word freedom, in fact, is designed to say that it's only a subclass of those words that are spoken, which in fact are going to be protected. And so then the question is, given this, how do we decide to do the question of what's protected and what's not? Well, it turns out that serious constitutional exposition does exactly the same thing with a high-class modern constitutional doctrine that we did with our lowly tort examples taken from Roman and early English law. The first thing you have to do is to figure out what the coverage provision is. And you go through exactly the same kind of sick joke sorts of arguments that you did before. Well, the police now start to arrest anybody. And they said, well, we're arresting you because you didn't speak. What do you mean I didn't speak? I was waving my hands to somebody to say, go forward. And so now the question is whether or not gestures are going to be covered if speech turns out to be covered. And you can sit around as long as you want, and you will not find any sane person who would say that a prohibition on the Constitution, which is designed to limit the power of government, will allow it to basically suppress those behaviors that are so analogous to the things that are protected that it becomes essentially improper for you to do that. So we're off to the races. And if you could start to do it with respect to gestures, what about writings and what about dance and what about art and so forth? And in the end, if you follow the system of analogies, all these things would be covered. But the textual difficulties leave people sufficiently uneasy that what many people do is they essentially amend the Constitution when they put it into the case books. So if you look at all the standard books, they don't talk about the protection of freedom of speech. They talk about the protection of freedom of expression, right? On the grounds that that's a much more accurate understanding. Well, they're quite innocent to do that, but instead of thinking of this as an illegitimate kind of ploy, understand it to be just simply the same kind of technique that's used with respect to other kinds of activities that are wrong, in which the anti-circumvention norm now applies to the government, which is the source of power that we're trying to limit, rather than to my obnoxious children, who were the source of power that we were trying to limit in those early examples. So that's the first thing I think that one immediately wants to do. And then the question is, well, under any circumstances, if in fact all forms of expression are protected, does that mean that we have to become a constitutional absolutist? And Justice Black is most famous for the proposition. It says, Congress shall make no law. You put the war word no in italics, and all of a sudden you realize that no matter what anybody does, it turns out that you can't stop the speech. And in a sense, what happens is he's italicized the wrong word. The right word to italicize turns out to be freedom of speech, and the way to recharacterize the amendment now is to say that Congress may pass no law abridging speech or expression unless it can justify it under some kind of a normative theory. All right, what normative theory do we use? Well, interestingly enough, if you recall the way in which I described this in the private law context, my view was essentially what you did is you came down to the classical liberal position, which says that the control on force and fraud is the essential feature of social organization, and that ordinary competition was a natural liberty to be protected by the state. You will notice that I'm bracketing at this particular point two very important classes of cases. One of those are common carriers and network industries, and the other turns out to be monopoly, for which is a nice long and complicated story that one can tell. But just leave those aside and start working about the kinds of things that we talked about before. And sure enough, what happens is you start going forward, you start seeing that there's some real justifications within the framework of this particular theory. And so there's the first class of cases are, of course, those cases in which it turns out that there's the use or threat of force against some private or public body, which is done under the name of freedom of speech. And so if you want to see whether or not the category is real, what you do is you take the most insistent case that falls within it, and you've got somebody who's in front of a raging mob, and it turns out to be some hapless person whom they'd like to lynch, and that person starts to say, charge, let's get him and hang him. At that particular point, are you going to accept the notion that somehow or other that's a protected form of speech? And if you understand what the libertarian situation is, you realize that the use of fraud necessarily requires communications between the fraudsters, the use of force requires communications between the force guys, and you are going to treat that, in this particular point, as being a wrong of the deepest dye. And so from this, what you now discover is that you have laws against incitement of riots, and you have laws against criminal conspiracies whose actions are to commit those actions, which when done by one person would be unlawful because of the way in which they trench upon anybody else. And if you want to figure out whether or not this is a small or a large thing, you have to run through a whole line of cases, starting with, you know, cases like the Masses and Debs and whatever, oh my God, Schenck against the United States and Abrams against the United States through Brandenburg, trying to figure out what we mean by this. And it turns out when you actually get through it, you're doing exactly the same issue on what it is to talk about a threat and the use of force and when the government can intervene as you are doing in the ordinary private case where there's one individual who says, if this were not a size time, Glenn, I would bop you over the head. And the issue as to whether or not that's an actionable threat or a conditional threat, and we start going to the question as to whether it's a clear or present danger on the one hand or whether or not it's a remote and uncertain one, and you're right back to the debate that existed with respect to these cases. So when you're starting to talk about the parallelism, it's the basic underlying linguistic logic of the propositions which drive the two things into perfect congruence. And the same thing starts taking place on the misrepresentation and fraud side, which is why it is that securities fraud is not protected activity under the United States Constitution, and why it is that the law of defamation as it developed at common law probably was a better approximation of the relevant interest than the rather screwed up law of defamation as it developed under New York Times against Sullivan against Gertz. But for these purposes, we're not trying to figure out how it is that you do the exposition. The key point to understand is that you cannot be faithful to the constitutional tradition If, in fact, you think that originalism requires that you only explicate the terms that are in the doctrine, in fact, what real originalism requires you to do is to go through the set of justifications that it does, and that forces you into a level of political theory which most originalists are not very happy with. And as I've indicated to you before, as you change the theory, you come up with very different kinds of results. So that if you now look, for example, at the voting cases in Citizens United and the McConnell case against the Election Commission, these are talking about very different kinds of harms. The imbalance to the political situation that happens when too many conservative corporations get to spend money, we only want that for labor unions, or maybe we want it for none. And generally speaking, the attitude that I have is if you don't bring yourself within the classical kinds of limitations as to the sorts of wrong, you're on the persuasion side of the line, and if one person is entitled to speak his mind publicly about a political issue, somebody else is in a position to help finance that, and it becomes the joint activity of both, and they should both be protected. And if you go through Citizens United, you can see that virtually the majority is using exactly that kind of casuistic and incremental common law language to justify the behavior and to limit the state power, whereas the liberals under this particular circumstances are using exactly the same kind of logic that you use in order to allow them to regulate wages under the Fair Labor Standards Act and airfares under the Civil Aeronautics Board and so forth. The differences, it turns out, are extremely powerful. So the thing that one has to understand is when you start with these techniques, their generative capacity is powerful enough to organize a complete code of constitutionalism if you stick with them to beginning or end. The difficulties that you get with modern constitutional interpretation is that the progressives on the one hand and the classical liberals on the other have fundamentally different views as to what the set of justifications are about. I think, in effect, when you're starting with a doctrine which talks about private property and freedom of speech, it's liberty and property that are the essential notions, and you'd like the justifications that are concordant with those particular ideas, and the progressives have rather different views because of their tendency wrong, I think as a matter of fact, that all monopoly, all competition ends up in monopoly and all monopoly ends up in destruction and so forth. Now, I don't have time to talk about the administrative state and various kinds of issues associated with it, but suffice it to say, these statutes are more complicated, but the same techniques of construction can, within limits, be applied to them, only now you have to bring into account all sorts of, you know, precedential stuff and so forth. I kept badgering everybody about Brown and Williamson this morning. As Mr. Duddy well knows, we've talked about that extensively in our FDA class, and it turns out the more you know about the statute, the less plausible the claim of the dissent turns out to be. So on these unhappy notes, I guess there's time for a few questions, but I think I better be quiet and forever hold my peace. Anyhow, thank you. Is there anyone who has one question? Ah, yes, you are the man. Scott?
This morning, when we were talking about and I was gesturing to Larry's common meaning. Mm-hmm. I said, well, the speaker, the ratifiers, they have in mind P, and others who are subject to the law, they have in mind P. What is this P? Mm-hmm. And you said, it's not a proposition. You said you have to import
a tradition.
And the question I have in mind is, what tradition?
This one.
And the same one in all, for all aspects of litigation that may come up with respect to this amendment, for example?
Let's just start with the first part of it, right? The tradition only tends to apply to the kinds of issues, at least as a first approximation, that were the source of the particular elements in question. So promising, partnerships, harm, you know, conspiracy and so forth, all the things that we were talking about are there. But when the next question comes, how does the tradition deal with copyright, of which there was none, right? How does it deal with the spectrum, of which there were none, and so forth? There is an answer to that question. I'll give you just the short version of it now. What happens is you first have to figure out how it is that the private bodies of law and the new sources of rights start to emerge. And essentially, the test that you ask in all of these cases, say about copyright, and this is a question on which you can then have a fight, is that if, in fact, we know what everybody's position was in a world without that kind of protection, do we, if we extend the copyright protection for a term of X, create an improvement whose benefits are shared by all? And in dealing with the First Amendment, what you have to do is to recognize that you have the Copyrights Clause and the Patents Clause elsewhere in the Constitution, which make at least an implicit judgment that some protection of this sort would, in fact, be appropriate. So then once you get those things out there, the hard question of institutional design at the legislative level is to figure out what we want this patent law to look like. And the biggest variable turns out to be a cross between content on the one hand and duration on the other. And generally speaking, I am on the side of those who believe that you get copyright protection, but shorter rather than longer turns out to be more optimal. And then you have all the boundary crossing conditions, which are analogous to tort, and we call that infringement. So what happens is the classical liberal project as applied to intellectual property essentially figures out, A, can we get a creator improvement by creating these things shared by everybody, and then B, how close are the analogies to the physical cases? And it turns out they're amazingly close if you understand the way in which the system turns out to be put together. And with the spectrum, it's exactly the same thing. You can have a system of original acquisition or a system of government grants. Once you create these things, you could create them as strong property rights with boundaries and essentially autonomy within the framework, or you could mess it up beyond all recognition as they did by calling them licenses that the government could revoke and so forth. So essentially, it's not as though you can't answer that question. It's just a slightly longer story. And sure enough, when they care about the First Amendment in their own crazy way, they get pretty close to what the right answers are. When they don't care about the traditional core values, as with campaign speech, they go off on a very different kind of reservation. So the view is, yes, if you understand the theory, it turns out that it has its own generative element that is associated with it. And this happens over and over again. With land, for example, nobody knew how to deal with air rights, right, in a world in which you had no airplanes, right? Once you introduce airplanes, how do you do it? And for the most part, the changes have been rather salutary, and they all fall within that particular element. So you got two traditions, right? You get the ones that they understand for the properties they know, and then you get another kind of techniques which allow you to assimilate the properties that you don't understand into the ones that you do. And it's a little bit about sort of figuring out how you understand circles only after you understand rectangles. And, you know, it's a very powerful analogy, and anyone who's ever done the math will realize just how elegant the solution is. And just as in the math, once you make the one move, right, define pi correctly, the rest of the theory just follows inexorably. This is an argument for slightly different from J.L. Austin in ordinary language, because the Austinian approach to language, as you know, was highly contextualized, and what he always wanted to do was to find a way in which a clever example would show you something about the language which you had missed. And there's nothing wrong with doing that. But it's the other side that's more important, the hard side of that business. I can show you the underlying unity with respect to these conceptions that other people did. So if you want, in your terms, the sort of the contrast, think of something like a plea for excuses on one side of the line, right? Or ifs and cans, which is the very clever Austinian stuff, and then look at the introductory chapters written about the same year, a couple years later, in Causation and the Law, where he's decrying all the realists who insist that they don't know what it means, and then trying to come up with a set of definitions. And you know why he breaks down? Because in the end, he doesn't have a strong enough normative theory on which to ground this stuff. So when he got to competitive harms, he was absolutely clueless as to what to do, as he admitted when I actually attended his lecture some 5 years later. I mean, this was a classic case of having ordinary language technology without general political theory gets you part of the way, but it can't get you all the way. You've got to know both techniques in order for this thing to work. One more question. Yes, Mr. Kinsella. This is going to be a hostile and friendly question at the same time. By a man who is more libertarian than I just want this audience to understand where it goes. Go ahead.
This will have to be the last question because we're running behind.
I understand. I know. We started late. We will end late.
Just regarding your comments about the First Amendment, I'm just curious. Two comments. I would say that we might want to put the emphasis on the word Congress in the First Amendment. Congress shall make no law to understand that the Bill of Rights does not apply to the states even after the 14th Amendment. I'm curious about your take on that. And second of all, you talk about the police power. Even if the First Amendment would not prohibit federal laws against certain types of speech, which I agree with you on that still doesn't mean that there's a general police power in the Constitution or that there's an enumerated power, so the feds have no power granted to stop any type of speech in the first place.
Those are the right questions to ask. Let's take the second one first. The argument that you're making basically illustrates a very important structural distinction in the use of the police power. One, the way in which I'm using it is the way in which Ernst Freund used it, which was those limitations necessary from the nature of things, i.e., in terms of this general traditional theory, that we put on the particular guarantees that are stated in the Constitution, right? And whether it's a contract clause and so forth. It is not supposed to be a grant of power to the federal government. It's just a way of saying that if it passes the statute that's within its powers for some other reason, it's going to be stopped by the First Amendment unless this happens. The kind of police power you're talking about is the question that says that the state has the general residual police power and the federal government only has these enumerated powers. But even the state government, if there were a state First Amendment, for example, operating under its general powers, would be running into a First Amendment limitation under its state constitution, which would then be subject to the second meaning of the police power. So there are two distinct meanings, and there's nothing about what I'm saying which is designed to do that. The key case on this was a case called Champion and Ames, where the dissent rightly pointed out, if you start allowing the control of interstate commerce to use indirect regulation of what goes inside the states, you're creating a federal police power of unlimited proportions. And that essentially turns out to be long-term history, perhaps one of the two or three most important structural decisions in the United States Supreme Court, because it indicates the way in which we get to the ultimate modern situation where the Commerce Clause is just about all embracing. Now, the second clause on incorporation, again, this is modern fantasy associated with the way in which this thing works. The longer history is something as follows, which is there is no incorporation through the Due Process Clause or anything else in the Constitution of the Bill of Rights against the particular states. But there is, after the passage of the Civil Rights Act, a Privileges and Immunities Clause, which says that no state shall make or enforce any law which abridges the privileges or immunities of the citizens of the United States or the citizens of the several states, right? This is not a narrow provision. And you've got to figure out what privileges and immunities turn out to be. And the privileges and immunities that are binding against the state turn out to be the traditional common law liberties that were preserved in England by charter to the various municipalities under grants from the king. It's probably the best one-sentence version. And these always cover those kinds of things. So you go back and you now look at Corfield and Coryell, which is the major American case that sort of construes this in the 1820s under the Privileges and Immunities Clause of Article 4. And what it sort of does is give you a fairly comprehensive list of those things for which I think freedom of speech and the right to own and hold and protect property would be there. They do it in Blackstonian form to some extent, so you're never quite sure of exactly what the scope is going to be, but it's there that you'd find it. What happens, of course, is that the Bill of Rights or the 14th Amendment is mangled in the slaughterhouse cases so that it applies only to federally protected claims, which is a narrow subset of the issues. After which, in order to get back from the original mistake, what they do is they use the Due Process Clause to do it. Originally, they do not do it through incorporation. Rather, in the rate-making cases of the 1890s, they say that the words without due process of law really mean without just compensation, so you get the parallelism between them. And from then, it's Gitlow, where the entire argument takes place, saying, well, for the sake of arguments, we will assume that the First Amendment applies to the state, because he was only concerned in upholding the single syndicalist statute. And if you had to throw away incorporation in order to strike down that statute, so be it. And it's just a classic illustration where the point that's conceded is a billion times more important than the one that turns out to be argued in these things. So that's how it is, and it's a very tangled history. And the hard task, and I'll end on this sense, of American constitutional law is, what do you do in order to rectify past mistakes once they became open and notorious? We've never had the courage to overrule the slaughterhouse cases, and we had no difficulty in overruling Plessy v. Ferguson, right? And therein, of course, lies the tale. I think I'm done. Thank you again.
Thank you, Professor Epstein. I'd like to invite the intellectual property law panel to come on up.
Stephanie, This is, yes, all right.
No, no, that's wonderful. Yeah. Thank you.
I opened it thinking I could give it to you.
Oh, perfect. Thank you so much.
Pepsi's okay?
Pepsi's yeah. Better.
Ozinga.
Ozinga. Z-I instead of S-E. But don't worry, my mother's list is
I'm going to show you the bios a little bit.
That's for the sake of time.
It's a nice turnout for Friday afternoon. It's beautiful in New York.
Epstein's a draw.
Yeah.
Although yours is already nice and short. Women do that. Right?
Probably.
I've noticed. It's something that tricky.
It's the PowerPoint.
There was others on there already. I just put one on there.
You guys
are
gone?
I'd like to introduce the moderator of the intellectual property law panel, Professor Amy Adler. Professor Adler is the Emily Kempfen Professor of Law at NYU. She's a specialist in the legal regulation of art, sexuality, and speech. Her scholarship focuses on the intersection of law and culture, and her work draws on an array of fields, primarily from the arts and humanities, to explore these legal questions. Professor Adler graduated from Yale University and Yale Law School and clerked for Judge John M. Walker, Jr. of the United States Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit.
So we have three spectacular panelists, and our first is Stefan Kinsella, whom you've already heard from today once in the questioning. He's a registered patent attorney and general counsel for Applied Optoelectronics, Inc. A former partner with Duane Morris, he has prosecuted hundreds of patent applications for high-tech clients, including Intel, GE, and others. He is a senior fellow of the Ludwig von Mises Institute, editor of libertarian papers, and director of the Center for Study of Innovative Freedom. And he's published numerous articles and books on intellectual property law, international law, and on the application of libertarian principles to legal topics, and just two titles, International Investment, Political Risk and Dispute Resolution, A Practitioner's Guide, and Against Intellectual Property. Stefan.
Okay. All right. Okay. Okay. It's nice to be here. As Amy mentioned, I am a practicing patent attorney. I'm also a libertarian, and I'm the only non-law professor, I think, here, although I do teach at Mises Academy some courses. So I have a little bit of teaching experience. What I would like to do is, in the 20 minutes allotted to me, give an overview of, you know, I've been practicing patent law for 18 years, and over this time I've developed my current views. And so I would like to just basically give the overview of what, I think the libertarian take on patents and copyrights are. So it's important to start with the origins of IP. Because there's a lot of ignorance about how patent and copyright law came to be. Basically, the origin is in favoritism and control by the Crown. There's a good study by Eric Johnson. It's a draft paper, and I won't read the quote, but and I'm going to post these slides later. There's hyperlinks here to a lot of these articles. So copyright came about when Queen Mary created the Stationers' Company in 1557. In order basically to control thought, to control what the printing press was going to be used for. So it was clearly designed originally for censorship purposes. When the charter expired, the publishers then asked, hey, we kind of like having this monopoly over what books get to be published. So they asked Parliament to pass a statute But Parliament wasn't so disposed to give a monopoly to the publishers. They gave it to the authors instead in the Statute of Anne, 1710. And one reason the authors were happy to, have this, and also in other countries of Europe where similar laws were being passed, was it, in a way, freed them from the censorship of the state. Now, they had the right to copy their own works. So it wasn't necessarily the same current attitude about, I have a copyright in this novel, and I can sue you if you copy without my permission. It was more to extract their own works from the control of the state. Now, as for patents, the English Parliament enacted the Statute of Monopolies in 1624, one of the first modern patent statutes. And it was a reaction against the practice of monarchs issuing letters patent, which granted monopolies to court favorites and goods or businesses which had long been enjoyed by the public. And some notorious examples would include Sir Francis Drake, who was a notorious, he was called a privateer, but he was really a pirate, who was given a letter patent in 1587. So this is an example of where patents granted by the state actually did cause piracy, but not the kind of piracy we have now, which is just file sharing. So then the statute banned these letters patent, but they carved out an exception for novel inventions. So this is the origin of patent and copyright. Okay, now how did it come to America? Actually, the first modern patent copyright in the world was South Carolina, 1691. But anyway, the Constitution was ratified 1789. There is a patent and copyright clause in there. And contrary to current wisdom, it was not based in natural law. Tom W. Bell explores this idea in detail in his draft book. Basically, even Locke didn't believe that patent and copyright could be justified by his homesteading theory, his natural law theory. It was done purely as a utilitarian measure to try to promote innovation and wealth. Now, the important thing to understand here is that studies have not proven this to be the case. In fact, studies are usually not attempted by advocates of IP. Back in the 50s, Fritz Machlup did a study commissioned by Congress. I believe he was sort of a quasi-Austrian economist. And he stated there, no economist on the basis of present knowledge could possibly state with certainty the patent system as it now operates confers a net benefit or net loss on society. And I agree with the first part of that. We can know that it confers a net loss because of the Austrian idea of utility and welfare economics. However, he says, if we did not have a patent system, it would be irresponsible on the basis of our present knowledge to recommend instituting one. Now, he was also against abolishing it because the system had was so entrenched. So this is in the 50s, and a lot of studies have been done since then. Okay, but in the meantime, what happens is because these clauses are part of the Constitution, and America's seen as the bastion of capitalism and private property rights, and because these rights started being called property later on, as Machlup notes, originally they were called monopoly or privilege, but people started using the word property in connection with it for a purpose, for propaganda purposes. They wanted to substitute a word property instead of the word privilege because it had more favorable connotations. Okay, so now what happens is it becomes part of the fabric of capitalism. So people who are generally in favor of property rights or the Western system just sort of assume that patent and copyright are one legitimate type of property right, especially because they're called intellectual property rights. This is the power of words. So what's interesting is nowadays people think of IP as a natural right, right, despite the fact that it was done for utilitarian purposes, or they'll argue for it on empirical grounds even though there's no evidence for it. Okay, and even though it really originated in monopoly grants of privilege and control by the crown. So in a way, it's similar to the minimum wage. Most economists seem to universally recognize that there's no proof showing that there's any empirical benefit that can be proven from the patent and copyright system. Just like most economists realize the minimum wage is completely counterproductive, and yet it's hard to kill politically. Okay, so what you have now is pro-property people, libertarians, propertarians, conservatives, even modern artists, they all now assume IP is part of a property rights system. And after all, the Constitution permits it. But on the other hand, I don't know if that's a ringing endorsement of patent, because the Constitution was, in my view, a mistake. It was a centralizing, power-grabbing coup. And it also condoned or permitted slavery, paper money, inflation, the business cycle, judicial supremacy, taxation, conscription, war, and drug prohibition. And if it doesn't permit these things, it has been helpless to stop it. In the words of Spooner, it's not worth having. And so Ayn Rand is also a big influence in modern libertarian circles. So Ayn Rand moves here from Russia. She sees the great freedom we have in America compared to Russia. But she's right. We were, by contrast, relatively free. And Ayn Rand was influenced by the Constitution. She thought it was a marvelous document, and so, you know, she buys into this idea, too, that property rights include patent and copyright. In fact, it influenced her whole philosophy, and where she actually has the completely absurd statement, patents are the heart and core of property rights. And other modern objectivists will actually say that all property is intellectual property. I actually think Ayn Rand's view on intellectual property was, and her view on anarchy, were her two biggest mistakes of her substantive philosophy. And on the other hand, in Murray Rothbard's correspondence, which has not yet been published, there's something in there indicating that he had been told that Ayn Rand originally even supported eminent domain because it's supported by the Constitution, but then she changed her mind about it later. So it just shows that she was taking the Constitution as sort of a template of what we should have. So basically, you have this assumption even by modern libertarians, but the problem is they are still artificial state monopolies. And what they do is they give the holder of this monopoly the power to go to a state court to use the force of the state against a competitor, say, who is using their own property in a peaceful manner because they don't want them to do it. Okay, so it basically is a redistribution of rights from the owner of a property right to the innovator of a way to use their own property. So basically, it's just a disguised way of redistributing property rights. Now, the libertarian perspective, which I adhere to, is that the goal of law and justice is not just tweaking incentives to produce innovation or maximize wealth or some social goal, even if you believe that the federal government were competent enough to do this without corruption and screwing everything up worse in the first place. The purpose of property rights is basically to reduce conflict over things that can be conflicted over, which is scarce resources. This is just so that they can be used peacefully for productive purposes so we can all live in peace and harmony together and have prosperity. So the purpose is this. And if you think about the Misesian idea of praxeology, which studies the structure of human action, this idea is that human action is basically, in a general sense, the use of means, scarce resources, to accomplish a desired goal. Now, if you think about it, what role do ideas or information play in this? Ideas and information are what we consult to guide our action, right? So the more knowledge I have, then I am aware of a larger universe of possible ends I can pursue, or a larger universe of means I can use to achieve my goals. The reason we have property rights in means is because they are scarce, and I can only use a means to achieve my end if I have the right to use it peacefully without someone fighting with me over it. I don't need property rights in the ideas, I just need to know the ideas. This is why these things are fundamentally different according to the structure of human action. So if you take an example, if I want to make a cake, I have to have certain scarce resources, including my body and standing room to stand on and a counter and an oven. I have to have a mixing bowl, I have to have a spoon, I have to have an egg and ingredients. If my neighbor takes these from me, I can't make the cake anymore, right? So I need property rights in this so that I can make the cake. If he has his own mixing bowl and his own spoon, he can make his own cake. We can both use the same recipe at the same time. Millions of people can use the same recipe at the same time. It doesn't make any sense to provide a property right in that recipe. Okay? And if you think about it, all these laws are always about scarce goods. When you have intellectual property advocates say that ideas are important, just as important as scarce resources, and that we should protect them as well. Well, the truth is, they don't advocate laws that enforce these patent and copyrights with intangible force, right? It always comes down to a dispute over who owns what. So, for example, if I assert my copyright or my patent against you and I take you to court, I'm asking the court to make a decision about who owns the perpetrator's body or his money in his bank, right? If I want $10,000 damages, I am seeking title to his money, okay? So it always comes down to a dispute about who owns things. But according to Lockean property rights, we know who owns the money. You know, the guy who owns it owns the money. He already owned it. And unless he makes a contract or commits a tort, he doesn't give up title to that money. So this is an example of why IP laws just amount to, they're just disguised transfers of wealth and property, okay? So basically, the problem with intellectual property, it's a way of undermining property rights. It undercuts the Lockean homesteading rule. So this is the reason why propertarians, or at least some of us libertarians, are anti-intellectual property for the same reason that we're against taxation and redistribution, because these are all invasions of property rights, okay? Now, another helpful way to think about this is to consider what the free market does. We live in a world of scarcity, right? It's maybe not easy to live and survive and to create things that, so we can get food and housing and clothing and other material goods we need. But the free market serves to unleash human energy and to allow us to cooperate with the division of labor, et cetera, to produce abundance in the face of scarcity, right? So we're dealt with a world of limited things, and yet the free market is always trying to create more goods, right? In a way, it's trying to fight scarcity. But luckily, the body of human knowledge is already non-scarce. It's already infinitely reproducible. It grows with every generation, which is one reason we have more productivity and progress in society, because the body of human knowledge grows, is added to, and is transmitted to the next generation. People can dip into it, learn from it, use these ideas as recipes to achieve their ends or to realize more ends that can be created. This is why it's so important to learn and to emulate, and the free market is built upon the idea of emulation, right? This is what competition is. You see a competitor doing something that the customers like, and you start doing what he's doing, or you do it better, or you tweak it, or you do half as well and sell at a cheaper price. This is how the market works. Consumers are benefited when there's competition, when there's emulation, and when there's learning, and we're all enriched by it. So to artificially impose scarcity on knowledge is suicidal, because it's trying to artificially hamper one of the two key aspects of successful human action. The free market is trying to overcome scarcity with real goods. Why would we impose scarcity on ideas? And by the way, advocates of IP explicitly admit that the goal of IP is to restrict the flow of information. They explicitly admit this. Now, let me switch to a second topic, a second way to look at another problematic aspect of intellectual property, which touches a little bit more on the theme of this symposium, which is about legislation and interpretation. There's a really fascinating series of sort of debates back in the 1800s. There was a guy named David Dudley Field who wanted to codify New York's common law, similar to the way that the law in the civil law states like Louisiana in America or the civil law countries in Europe. Codify their law into a legislated code, which is the sole or supreme source of law. So he wanted to do this, and James Carter was commissioned by the New York Bar to write a critique of this. And Carter was a strong advocate of the common law, and the common law, remember, is the decentralized way of making law. You have judges, right, who hear disputes and they make rules, and this way the common law grows. So, by the way, did the Roman law, which was largely a decentralized legal system as well. So even though the civil law, this is a legal matter, the civil law, like in Louisiana, France, really is the descendant of the Roman law in terms of its content. It's really an embodiment of legislative supremacy, legal positivism, because it's basically the legislature saying we're the sole source of law, and this code is the supreme source of law. Whereas the Roman law and the common law were kind of like cousin systems. They're both decentralized systems of law. So they actually have more in common with each other than the civil law and the Roman law do in many ways. Okay, so there's a beautiful quote. I'll try not to read the whole thing, but it's a great quote by Carter because he's so passionate. So he says, and it's a good summary of the difference between legislation and common law. And the reason I'm going into this is because patent and copyright are purely legislated creations. You could not have patent and copyright without there being a patent statute or a copyright statute. They could never arise in a court system any more than the Americans with Disabilities Act or the Income Tax Code could. It would be just dicta, right? So the problem I'm trying to establish here is show why legislation is not only not the best way of making law, it's not a legitimate way of making law at all. This is even if you're not an anarchist, as I am, but even if you're just a minarchist libertarian, you still shouldn't want there to be legislation as a way of making law at all. The only legislation I would support would be legislation shutting down the federal government. So at present, when any doubt arises in any particular case as to what the true rule of the unwritten law is, and by that he means common law, it is at once assumed that the rule most in accordance with justice and sound policy is the one which must be declared to be law. The search is for that rule. So you see what he's saying is that at least in a common law system, there's a chance you can have a just rule because the participants are trying to find justice. They're trying to award the property to the person with the best claim to it. They're trying to give a restitutionary award to the wrong party. They're trying to do justice. They might make mistakes, but at least there's a possibility because that's what it's about, right? But when the law is conceded to be written down in a statute and the only question is what the statute, means, a contention unspeakably inferior is substituted. The dispute is about words. The question of what is right or wrong, just or unjust, is irrelevant and out of place. The only question is what has been written. And I love this last sentence. What a wretched exchange for the manly encounter upon the elevated plane of principle. Now, let me see how much time I have. I've got a couple minutes. So I'll go through some of the I'll go through some of the pernicious effects of legislation as a means of making law. And some of the best studies that have been done on this have been by Bruno Leone and Giovanni Sartori, two brilliant Italian legal theorists, both deceased. Leone was murdered by a client. So what Leone pointed out was one pernicious aspect of legislation is that it reduces legal certainty in a given society. And the reason is because, it's sort of like that bumper sticker, no man's property is safe when the Congress is in session. Right, because the Congress can change the law by decree the next day at any time. In fact, we see this right now with, say, banks and mortgages because, they don't know if Congress is going to all of a sudden come in and prohibit foreclosures of mortgages, ruining the certainty or the ability to count on the property right of the mortgage, so now you're not going to loan this is just a current modern example. But the point is, legislation, if that takes over as the key source of the key way of making law, then you have more uncertainty in society. And many studies have been done that show tons of pernicious effects of uncertainty. It raises time preference, causes crime, causes parties to resort to inefficient practices to get around the uncertainty, et cetera. I'll skip that here. Okay, now one other thing is, so you have a situation where today, even libertarians, everyone nowadays thinks of law as the law is what's on the law books. You'll hear this all the time, what's on the law books, right? So they think of law as being made by the government. So that's a legal positivistic mentality. So it kind of cuts the connection between law and justice. It's just whatever the government says. And, well, of course, this is going to lead to special interest warfare where people try to get their kind of statute passed to protect their interests. It's going to make everyone a lawbreaker. There are so many laws because you'll have a proliferation of laws like we have now. We're all lawbreakers, all of us. We're all criminals. So that gives the government the power to pick and choose and to use its discretion to decide who is going to persecute next. And it also leads to the lack of respect for the law because you don't think of the law as being a fair set of rules anymore. You think of it as just whatever was dictated by the government, by the state. And I will stop there. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Professor Kristen Ozinga. Am I getting that right? She's an associate professor at the University of Richmond School of Law, where she teaches intellectual property, including patent law, trademark, and unfair competition law, and international intellectual property law. She has a degree in biomedical engineering from the University of Iowa, a master's in electrical engineering from Southern Illinois, and a JD from University of Illinois College of Law, where she graduated magna cum laude in Order of the Coif. She has worked prior to entering academia at the intellectual property law firm of Finnegan Henderson in Washington, D.C., and she clerked for Judge Lynn on the Federal Circuit.
Great. Thank you. And I want to first thank the journal. As a patent scholar, I never get invited to come and play with language scholars, and this is really a treat for me. And I don't usually sit by people like Stefan and say patents are just bad and evil. So that's also a treat. So this is just exciting all around for me. But what I want to talk about is, how do we interpret the words of patents? Because I think that there's a lot of chatter about it in the patent world, and I think what we are desperately missing out on is the work of the language folks, the linguistics folks, that would really assist us as patent people in understanding. And so what I have started doing in my career for the last 5 years or so is stealing what they do and trying to put it into patent law. And with varying levels of success. So I'm going to talk to you about that today. So you may or may not have gotten from Stefan's comments about patents. Patents are basically a monopoly. And the thing about the patent monopoly is that it's defined by words. There's no fence that you can put around an idea. The only way that you can define your idea and carve it off from the rest of the world is to use words. And there's some unfortunate historical issues with the words that are used for patents. Early on in patent times, we have what was called central claiming. So basically you read a story, and what the judge would do is he would read it and he'd say, wow, okay, there's your invention, I got it, let's go. That made it hard, though. It made it hard for the judge to read a big, long description of what was going on and say, oh, that's what's good about yours. And so we moved from a system of central claiming to peripheral claiming, where the patentee had to list out exactly, this is my territory. And unfortunately, when the patent system changed to be that way, it's one sentence. You have one sentence that says, I claim a chair that has four legs and a seat and a back and a cushion and a whatever, period. And they're rather unwieldy, and there's no really good reason for that, but that's neither here nor there. It's just to get you into the story. So we have these claims that come at the end of the patents. The claims define the territory of the exclusion. The claims are very hard to read, and not simply because they're one sentence. And so the problem is the interpretation of these claims. And we have some law, not surprisingly, of how we're supposed to do it. We are supposed to, when we interpret patent claims, give the words their ordinary and customary meaning, which sounds an awful lot like plain meaning, the ordinary and customary meaning that would be given to the words by a person having ordinary skill in the art. And just because I like to say it, that's the foceta, person having ordinary skill in the art, foceta. And so you give the ordinary and customary meaning as would be given by a foceta consistent with the specification. So we have plain meaning, we have this ordinary and customary meaning, but we also have some context. We have the context both of the ordinary and customary meaning is from the perspective of the foceta, and we also have the context that the surrounding writings, right? There's the front part of the patent, which isn't the claims, but it's the story part. You're supposed to read the claims in light of that. So we have written context, we have constituent context, and that's what we're supposed to do. And that's how we interpret patent claims, and this is how we determine what the monopoly is, and this is how we determine who's infringing. And all of this is really great, but it doesn't work. basically, there's a ton of uncertainty, and so the tools we've been using don't seem to be working. So just some ideas about that. The concern with the boundaries is if you're on this side of it, you're not infringing, and if you're on this side of it, you are, and you're liable, and that's not good. Or from a more positive point of view, if you're the competitor and the patent's over here, you want to know where this territory is so you can open a business in the right place. So there's a number of different constituents that need to decide where these lines are between them. So we need to know where these boundaries are, because the boundaries are not a fence, they're a set of words, they're very hard to deal with. And then the problems range from things like this. The reversal rates between the district court and the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit have been measured about 33% to 40%. What they say the boundary is at the district court gets flipped about a third of the time when it comes up to the Federal Circuit. That's not really good, right? That's like really bad, just to say. We have a number of different constituents. When these claims are drafted, they're drafted by a patent attorney, who is an engineer who went to law school and forgot everything they knew about science. They're drafted based on information given to them by the inventor, who knows nothing about law but knows an awful lot about the science. They're read by judges that don't know anything. And so when these are drafted, they're being drafted and read and written by all different sorts of parties that aren't coming to it with that same shared background that you heard about this morning, so I want to talk more about that, but that's another problem. And then we don't know what we're doing, so the best place to look when you don't know how to define a word is naturally the dictionary, right? Isn't that the first place y'all go when you don't know how to define a word? Yeah. There's a very unfortunate Federal Circuit case, an en banc case, to talk about how to construe these patent claims from 2005, and it says, the best use of a dictionary is when you already know what the word means. Seriously? And so we don't know what we're doing. All of these are examples to show you that in patent law, we don't know how to interpret these claims. And just another little story about dictionaries, because it amuses me to no end. Federal Circuit had to come up with the meaning of the word hydrosol. Hydrosol is a very scary word, right? Are you guys scientists out there? Go, good. Because when I do this with patent people, they're like, oh, yeah. Hydrosol is a scary word for me because I'm an electrical engineer. And so the Federal Circuit gets it. It's in a claim. They don't know what it means. So they go to a dictionary. It's like Merriam-Webster's collegiate, whatever. And it says hydrosol is a sol with water. Oh, wow, okay, it's a sol with water. Ah, it's got it. And so then they, like, well, we don't know what a sol is. And I'm like, good, I don't either. So they look up sol, and sol simply means salt, dissolved. So now we have a salt dissolved in water. And you're like, wow, that's great. They found that in the same dictionary. And you think we're good to go now, right? Think we're ready to move on, apply some law, because we have salt dissolved in water? Well, the Federal Circuit decides they don't know what dissolved means. Okay, but they don't look in the Merriam-Webster dictionary that they'd used for the last two definitions. They pull an entirely different dictionary off the shelf to look for the word dissolved. Anybody see a problem with this? Right? This is a results-driven thing. They wanted it to come out a certain way, and the word, the way dissolved was defined in the Merriam-Webster that they'd used for the last two definitions didn't work for them, so they pulled it. Anyway, claim construction is a big, hairy mess at the Federal Circuit, at the lower courts, because they don't know what's going on. And so this is where I came into being interested about this, because I want to fix this, or at least tell them how they should fix it, or just have something to write about. And so I'm like, well, why are we having a hard time with this? These are just words, right? We should know how to do this. In fact, there have been people who have done studies. What are these words that are causing problems at the Federal Circuit? The Federal Circuit has more than one occasion defined the word A. They have defined the word the. They have defined the word about. And you're like, well, that's stuff we understand in everyday language. Why is this so hard? And so those ideas came together in my head. I'm like, everyday language, understanding, there's people out there that know how to do this. And that's where I started poking into some of the language scholarship, the linguistic scholarship. And I will just say right now, I'm not a linguist. Because I'm pretty sure that when I was in school, in high school, I didn't know what a linguist was, so I didn't go to college to become one. And I'm really regretting that decision now, because I think it suits my personality a little better than engineering ever did. Okay, so what am I doing? What am I taking from what they're doing, what Scott and Larry and Peter are doing, and bringing into mine? And I do want to say, I saw the panel for this morning, and I'm like, wow, I've cited all of you like 800 times, and that's really exciting to me. So just made me happy to see you all here. Okay, so when I first started, I was like, okay, what do we do? Let's just pick out some, cherry-pick some ideas about linguistics and understanding words and see what we can do with patent law. And one of the first things that bothered me instantly was the use of the dictionary and stuff like that. And I didn't know really where to go with it. So I pulled out some ideas. You know, we should probably use a dictionary to look up words we don't know rather than words we do. We should probably pay attention to what we did before, okay? In patent law, there's no such thing as stare decisis. Well, there's stare decisis in patent law, but not with respect to patent claims. So if they define the word A in patent number one, the word A in patent number two doesn't necessarily mean the same thing, or in patent number three, or in patent number five. I'm like, well, that's not okay. I'm like, we need to really have some sort of, not necessarily stare decisis, but a general idea of how these words are being defined over and over again, so we don't have to decide what A means all the time was another thing. A third thing that I thought about in the first paper I wrote was there's this foceta, this person having ordinary skill in the art, very fact-based guy, right? or girl, fact-based guy or girl. The Federal Circuit claims to bring the foceta into the picture, but we don't know who this person is. They say it has to be determined by, you know, on the basis of who the foceta is, and then they never say anything more about it. And there's two problems with that. First, how do we know what he thinks if we don't know who he is? And second, shouldn't we have some deference since it's such a fact-based thing? Well, claim construction is reviewed de novo at the Federal Circuit. So any determinations that are fact-based made on who this foceta is and what he knows disappear when it gets to the Federal Circuit. So that was my early paper, and you know, I got really interested in it, and then I didn't know what to do with it. So then I moved on, and my second paper along this lines has to do with cooperative patent prosecution. And the idea of this is that, as people have said this morning, when you have a conversation, when you're trying, the speaker is speaking, intending that the hearer hears him and understands and gets the point that he's coming from, and the listener is supposed to be listening and saying, oh, somebody is speaking to me and I should try to understand it. And that's not how patents are created, which is unfortunate. Basically, the way patents are worked is it's not unsimilar to how statutes are drafted, right? The legislators sit around, they make deals and backroom bargains and what have you, and something comes out the door. And that's probably cynical, but that's how it happens. But with respect to patent drafting and patent granting, what it is that there's a bunch of little conversations that take place, and everybody involved in them has a different interest, and none of them has cooperation in mind. So we have the inventor talking to the attorney. That's your first little conversation. And the inventor is saying, I have this really cool stuff, get me protection. And the patent attorney is saying, that's not really not that cool, but I'm going to make up some stuff to go with it. So you have this conversation where they're trying to, he's coming in and saying, I got good stuff, and this guy's saying, no, you don't really, but let me fake it. So that's your first conversation. That's not really cooperative. Okay, that's kind of not good. Okay, but more important than that, that conversation is minor compared to the next one. The next one is the attorney speaking on behalf of the patentee to the patent office, okay? And so we have this agency, and we can talk about all sorts of agency problems too, and how we defer to them, but that's, we'll save that for later. You have the patent attorney, and what he wants is for the patent office to know as little as humanly possible. Because the littler they know, the bigger the patent's going to end up being, okay? So he says, he comes in the door, patent attorney comes in the door and says, I want you to just look at this little tiny piece and say it's all good to go, okay? So not very cooperative. He's like hiding stuff, kind of. The patent office, on the other hand, what their goal is speed, okay? And so the patent office says, hey, looks good to me. And doesn't take the time to clarify. Whereas if we were having a conversation, presumably the patent attorney would come in and say, hey, I want to have a conversation with you, and here's what I want to tell you, and not hide. And the patent office would say, gosh, that's great. Oh, and I didn't understand that. Could you explain it a little better? And that would be a normal cooperative conversation. Here instead we're coming in and saying, I have something to hide, and the other guy says, I don't care as long as I get through it fast. And then the last part of the conversation is very, very similar to statutes, is the idea that the statute is speaking, or the patent is speaking and saying, this is my territory. And very similar to a statute, there's no ability to question it. It wasn't based necessarily on a cooperative conversation itself. And so we end up with this very non-cooperative process all the way through that looks like a conversation, but we can't use all the same tools that we do in normal conversation to understand it. Which is kind of what I was hoping at the time, is, oh, I could say, oh, it's like a conversation, so let's apply conversation theory to the patent, and well, it doesn't work. And so that was that. Am I still good?
No, you're still good.
Okay, good, because then there's one more paper, and that's the one I'm working on now. But just to tell you where all of these are coming from, because basically I see this problem is patent claim construction is a big, huge language pile, and I just keep poking at it from different directions trying to find out which one works, and I haven't found one yet. But the last one is the idea of the boundaries and the kind of a definitional sort of thing. And this one isn't as easy to talk about because I'm not quite done with it, but that's okay. The deal here is that in patent law we say, here's your boundary, and we realize that's not very good. It doesn't work. There's too many exceptions. There's too many things that we can't think about when we define it. All of the things I'm in my southern mode. Gentlemen. Y'all are gentlemen. That'll work. that the gentleman we're talking about this morning is that, you know, if you say this and they take one step over the line, are they in, are they out? That's the sort of the concern. And so what we do in patent law is we have something called the doctrine of equivalence, which basically says if the line is here, we know you can't write words that exactly define this line. So we're going to give you some fuzzy area to the outside of the line to make up for the fact that you can't draft a perfect claim. Okay? And so we have this thing called doctrine of equivalence, and this is this really hideous doctrine that doesn't work well, that the Federal Circuit has tried to kill. The Supreme Court says, no, you can't kill it, but it's kind of killed anyway, and there's been a lot of law trying to figure out exactly what means, what still exists of the doctrine of equivalence. Where is this little fuzzy boundary? And my thought is basically this, is that We don't need the doctrine of equivalence. We need to acknowledge that language works that way anyway. We don't need a doctrine to say, hey, people understand that words are fuzzy. We need to say, hey, words are fuzzy, so we don't need a patent, or we don't need a doctrine to explain it. And so the ideas I'm exploring are kind of this idea of definitional versus prototype definitions and creating a taxonomy that isn't rigid. And I'm going to leave it there.
Great.
Okay.
Great. Terrific.
Our last panelist is Professor Barton Beebe, who has been on the faculty of NYU as a professor of law since the fall of 2009. And his scholarship focuses on the doctrinal, empirical, and cultural analysis of intellectual property law. And I have to editorialize for a minute because I've read a lot of his scholarship, and it's so fascinating, and I commend it to you. Prior to joining our faculty, Professor Beebe taught at Cardozo Law School, where he won the award for best professor in 2007. He visited at Stanford. He has served as a special master in Louis Vuitton Malletier versus Dooney and Bourke in the Southern District. He graduated from Yale Law School. He has a PhD in English literature from Princeton, and he has a BA from the University of Chicago, Phi Beta Kappa, and clerked for Judge Denise Coate in the Southern District.
Okay, thank you very much. I realize I'm the last speaker between you and an absolutely beautiful afternoon in New York, so I will try to be brief, as brief as possible. First, a word or two about this lovely talk about intellectual property as monopoly. And so I'm very interested to hear after, I'll try to leave some time, about the incentives theory and the idea that the reason that intellectual property restricts the flow of speech in the short term is to encourage the greater flow of speech in the long term. And just the more general public goods problem that intellectual property seeks to address. I'm sympathetic in my heart to your ideas, and I'm looking for good responses. As far as IP being a creature of statute entirely, I think, you know, there are good histories of common law copyright and misappropriation out of the common law courts that might be addressed as well. Though again, my heart is more or less with you. So let me talk primarily about trademark law. We've heard about patent law, which is usually what happens at these kinds of panels. But I actually think trademark law is the most important form of intellectual property, and the others can sort of follow along. And what I will talk about is the focita in trademark law. This is the person having ordinary skill in the art of consumption of the relative goods and services. The reason I want to talk about this focita in trademark law is that in trademark law, the consumer is the measure of all things and is the source of all meaning in trademark law. Trademarks exist only to the extent that consumers perceive them as designations of source. Infringement occurs only to the extent that consumers perceive one trademark as referring to the source of another. We say in trademark law, if a tree falls in the forest and no consumer is there to hear it, the tree makes no sound. All right, it's that simple. Nearly every doctrinal issue in trademark law, functionality is the major exception, turns on the question of the meaning that that an appreciable majority of the relevant consumer population attributes to some sign, some word, some whatever. If we use dictionaries, it is to figure out what other people think or what the majority of people think. If we use survey evidence, and we do increasingly now use survey evidence, it is to do the same. Consider the example of Judge Frank, who in 1948 roamed the halls of his courthouse, conducting a rough survey related to the case before him. The issue in the case was whether the defendant's 17 brand girdles would be perceived as coming from the same source as the plaintiff's 17 brand magazine. In his dissent, Judge Frank writes the following, and it's a long paragraph, but I think it's worth reading. Like the trial judges, our surmise must here rest on judicial notice, as neither the trial judge nor any member of this court is or resembles a teenage girl, or the mother or sister of such a girl. Our judicial notice apparatus will not work well unless we feed it with information directly obtained from teenagers, which he puts in quotes, or from their female relatives accustomed to shop for them. Competently to inform ourselves, we should have a staff of investigators like those supplied to administrative agencies. As we have no such staff, I have questioned some adolescent girls and their mothers and sisters, persons I have chosen at random. I have been told uniformly by my questionees that no one could reasonably believe that any relation existed between plaintiff's magazine and defendant's girdles.
All right? So the problem with trademark laws, use of the faceta-like figure to establish meaning, is that, well, judges have to roam courthouse hallways or now rely on survey experts of dubious honor, some of them, to figure out what the person having ordinary skill in the art of the consumption of the relevant goods actually thinks about the trademarks at issue. And one important factor in this analysis is the sophistication of the relevant consumer population. So in order to determine meaning in trademark law, we cannot just think of the general consumer in the American population. We have to focus in on the consumer population that is concerned with consuming the goods at issue. A further problem is that the sophistication of the average faceta in trademark law varies according to the politics or the policy preferences of the trademark commentator. And so what I'll talk about in the time remaining is this variance, not just in litigants' views of the faceta, but also in policymakers' views of this giver of meaning, this consumer, who's the lens through which we see everything in trademark law. What I'll talk about first is consumer sophistication in search. I think this is the simple idea, consumer sophistication when consumers look at things on shelves. Consumer sophistication when it comes to how consumers interpret signs in the marketplace. Then I'll talk about something a bit different, which my understanding is hasn't really come up too much today, and that is a different sort of import that comes with words or signs, and that is persuasion. So what I'll talk about is consumer sophistication with respect to persuasion attempts directed at them. Because in trademark law, when we talk about meaning, we don't simply mean to refer to the semantic content of some sign. We're not talking about mathematical formulas. We also mean to refer to the persuasive import of the sign. In fact, when we talk about meaning nowadays, we're probably talking more about rhetoric, about persuasion, than we are about, I don't know, semantic content, whatever that is. All right. So first, a word or two about search sophistication, about the sophistication of the people upon whom we rely as sources of meaning in trademark law. It is an irony in trademark law that the plaintiff is often placed in the strange position of arguing that its consumers are, well, fools, easily confused, and that the goods that the plaintiff is selling to these people are rather commonplace and not really worthy of much analysis or attention in the marketplace. Meanwhile, the defendant argues to the court that the plaintiff's consumers are actually quite sophisticated people. After all, look at the plaintiff's products that they're buying, and that the plaintiff's products are quite exceptional. This is because, in trademark law, the scope of protection accorded to a trademark is inversely related to the degree of consumer sophistication that is attributed to the relevant consumer population. More consumer sophistication results in a lesser scope of protection, less sophistication in a greater scope of protection. Let me give you some examples that make this very clear. These are extreme examples, but they make the case clear. First Circuit case involving the mark Astra. Two companies used exactly the same trademark, A-S-T-R-A, on medical equipment. And the court wrote that the decision to buy a machine worth thousands of dollars is obviously not done on an impulse and involves a careful consideration of the reliability and dependability of the manufacturer and seller of the product. Therefore, no confusion. Two companies can use exactly the same mark on more or less the same goods, but because we're dealing with highly sophisticated consumers, no problem. This is my even favorite. My trademark students have already heard about this. The recent Canadian case that dealt with two marks, both for the same services, and both marks were essentially the letter A. Just the letter A, one was stylized in one way, the other mark was stylized in a slightly different way. Court wrote, all of the plaintiff's experts acknowledged in cross-examination that the relevant consumers would not be confused into purchasing the wrong nuclear reactor by the similarity of the marks. Elsewhere in the opinion, and I hope these aren't just cheap jokes. This is this is our source of meaning in trademark law, as it really relies on not on the judge, not even really on the jury, but on this population of people out there, the reader's response. In this case, the court declined to apply the, quote, moron in a hurry test. That's a test we refer to in trademark law. And this is lovely. This Canadian court wrote, in this industry, the fact that Homer Simpson may be confused is insufficient to find confusion. All right. So that's one side. At the one extreme, we interpret meaning through the lens, through the eyes of extremely sophisticated consumers who are not easily confused by anything and who don't even need to consult or would need to consult the dictionary because they know every word in the language. On the other extreme, we have a case like in the Northern District of California. dealing with wine consumers, and it found as a matter of apparently judicial notice that American wine consumers are highly unsophisticated, at least outside the borders of San Francisco Bay with respect to wine. Then we have out of the Southern District of New York, a lovely case in which the court observed sort of along, you know, in passing, even if some of the prospective purchasers of the champagne are from low-income groups and are therefore less sophisticated shoppers than wealthier purchasers, and the court continued, therefore attributing. This later court took issue with this and said, actually, poor people, they might be more sophisticated because they can't just throw their money around in anything they want, like Dom Perignon champagne, which was at issue in this case. So there is this spectrum, and there's a limit to this spectrum, which I think, again, you know, it's interesting how courts try to come to terms with the limits of human comprehension in trying to attribute meaning to objects in the marketplace. Courts will say in these lovely phrases, defendant, a plaintiff has come before us with evidence of maybe 5% confusion. They've shown some people are confused, anecdotal evidence, but, quote, befuddlement is part of the human condition, unquote. Another court. Some people are always confused, you know? Look, you know, so we won't find confusion in this case. Instead, in our hermeneutics or whatever you want to call it, in our interpretation, we will look for the average consumer. So far, so good. I think you get the idea of this spectrum of sophistication in the relevant consumer population when we are litigating a case. Now let me talk about trademark commentary. So trademark professors are notorious for not really being at one with the trademark bar because we tend to be hostile to trademark protection. And one thing that we often complain about is the level of sophistication that is typically attributed to the faucida in trademark law. And we say that, you know, things like courts seem to assume that consumers are, quote, presumptive idiots, unquote, or Pavlovian fools is another phrase. And we tend to argue that consumers are actually much more sophisticated. We do this in order to support the argument that the scope of protection given to trademarks should narrow significantly. Meanwhile, apologists for trademark protection, just as plaintiffs would in trademark cases, tend to argue that, you know, in general, trademark, that consumers are in a hurry, they've got other things to think about, they're not going to attribute that much care to their purchasing decisions. This is to support the expansion of scope in trademark law. Now let me complicate things a bit and turn to the issue of persuasion and persuasion sophistication, and propose to you that we can say there is also a spectrum of persuasion sophistication among a relevant consumer population, and that this spectrum has important implications for trademark law and ultimately for how we view this interpretive population, the sophistication of this population, and ultimately what our political commitments are with respect to democracy and voting and all of this other stuff. So what I will take advantage of is the concept of persuasion sophistication. This is based on various marketing literature, and the idea here, I think, at one level is very straightforward. The idea is that consumers employ persuasion heuristics or schema that enable them to cope with marketplace persuasion. So you see the hard sell on TV, and you see through it, you know what the beer companies are up to with the way they advertise. You think it's ridiculous, and it has no effect on you. That's sort of, you know. We see references to persuasion sophistication in the case law, but this is typically from cases in the 1950s and 1960s when judges would actually volunteer that they were hostile to trademark protection. Now judges are much less likely to do so. What we see much more often is references to persuasion sophistication in the trademark commentary. Here, trademark restrictionists, like most trademark professors in the academy, rail against trademark protection because they say it facilitates marketplace persuasion, which is bad. One of the first great professors to do this was Ralph Brown, the late dean of sort of the restrictionists, who listed consumers' sales resistance, his phrase, a compound of realism, skepticism, and apathy, unquote, as one possible force that could counter advertising propaganda. That was his term, propaganda. But he set little store in sales resistance and suggested that consumers were essentially defenseless against persuasion attempts. On this basis, Brown argued that we should restrict the scope of trademark protection. Brown said trademarks are deluding people, persuading them to buy things at higher prices than those things should actually be sold. So we should try to restrict the power of trademarks by restricting their scope of protection. So that's the restrictionist view with respect to persuasion sophistication. Now what about the apologist view? We can refer to Landis and Posner, who, as is their way, reject this whole argument, arguing the power of brand advertising to bamboozle the public and thereby promote monopoly has been rejected by economists. End of sentence, move on. all right? Thank you very much, all right? So that's a little unfair. They deleted this particular phrase, and when they republished the article and tried to give a little more to it. But anyway, that's about how dismissive they are with respect to this argument. So there we have, I've discussed the restrictionist and apologist view with respect to search sophistication and their view with respect to persuasion sophistication. Now there's a bit of a problem where I want to bring these two views together. First, consider trademark plaintiffs and apologists, all right? So plaintiffs in trademark cases and also members of the academy who argue in favor of trademark protection. They argue that consumers are generally not sophisticated in search. You may recall that they do so because this supports a broad scope of protection. So consumers are, you know, reasonably easily confused when they're looking through the supermarket for various things. At the same time, they argue that consumers are generally sophisticated in persuasion. No need to worry about trademark protection because it turns out consumers are not bamboozled by the hard sell on television. They can easily see through all this advertising, no problems. But when they go into the store and look for the product, then maybe they do have problems. Meanwhile, trademark defendants and restrictionists sort of argue the inverse. Restrictionists argue that consumers are generally sophisticated in search. Recall that the idea here is to suggest consumers are actually take good care, they're not easily confused, let's restrict the scope of trademark protection. At the same time, restrictionists argue that consumers are generally not sophisticated in persuasion. Consumers are easily bamboozled by the hard sell. Trademarks create artificial product differentiation. This is bad. People shouldn't buy Louis Vuitton purses because they're wasting their money on, you know, vanities. All of this stuff should be prevented by restricting the scope of trademarks protection and the power of trademarks. My question to you is if it's fair to say that there is some tension in both of these views with respect to a person's search sophistication on the one hand and persuasion sophistication on the other. Perhaps there is no tension. Perhaps the utterly deluded consumer is, by virtue of his delusion, especially attentive in search. The idea here is that you care so much about the Gucci purse versus the Louis Vuitton purse or whatever else that you're especially careful when you walk into the store to buy one versus the other. And perhaps the utterly persuasion-resistant consumer cares little about the particular products he buys because he considers them to be all the same. You know, I'll buy any car. They're all the same. It's all these advertisements are ridiculous. Four wheels and a steering wheel. I'm fine. So I have two responses, and with this I'll conclude, to any such attempt to maintain appearances or to preserve some sort of balance between these two sides of our analysis of consumers. The first is empirical. As an empirical matter, search sophistication appears to correlate positively with persuasion sophistication. It is well established that consumers with low search sophistication are also more likely to have a low degree of persuasion sophistication. We can argue about this. I'm less interested in the empirical question than I am in the theoretical question. This is the second objection. To formulate a theory of the consumer as sovereign in one sense and fool in another is to formulate a theory not just of the consumer, but also of the citizen, right? One's theory of trademark law, it must be emphasized, is a species of one's theory of politics. And as a theory of politics, the apologists and restrictionist schools offer us in this schizoid consumer the worst of each of their worlds. So, you know, think about it. The political economic subject is either confused in search or deluded in persuasion. He either chooses on instinct, but mistakenly chooses other than what his instinct instructed him to choose, search confusion, I know what to get, but I walk into the store and I choose the wrong thing. Or he chooses what he intended, but chooses it according to external commands. I've lost control of my preferences because of all this advertising, but at least when I walk into the store, I know what I'm looking for and can find it. So in either case, the subject may be said to have lost control of the ends of his actions, to have lost his sovereignty. And the much larger argument goes to the whole issue of consumer sovereignty and individual sovereignty. This schizoid consumer simply cannot form the basis of a coherent politics, and it follows of a coherent theory of trademark law. So I think hopefully the plain meaning thing is sort of woven into that last paragraph, not enough, but in any event, hopefully the implications are clear.
So before we take questions from the audience, I wanted to ask the panelists if any of you would like to respond to each other, if there's anything that you've been provoked by today.
I've got a couple. I'm just curious, in if you deal with the patent law doctrine that you can be your own lexicographer in your writing, and how do you incorporate that with this dictionary idea? And maybe you can explain what the doctrine is if people don't know it.
Yeah, sure. There is a doctrine in patent law that the patentee is entitled to be his own lexicographer, so that if in the patent document he says, every time I say the word green, I mean blue, then the word green means blue. More often than not, as a matter of reality, I think patentees are hesitant to do that because the minute they offer an explanation, they lose their wiggle room. Whereas if they say blue is blue and then they get to court and they say, and it could be green too, I think that although the lexicographer is a big part of patent law doctrine, I don't think it's used as often. And so I usually just kind of ignore it. I mean, I know it's there, but I would never tell a client to use it and lose their wiggle room.
Gotcha.
So I'm really curious to know about the libertarian response to the incentives theory.
Okay, so I mean, there are different types of libertarians. Some are more empirical or consequentialist. So first of all, I would refer you to, I'm more of an ethical type libertarian. I mean, my primary approach is on whether a law is justified or not. For example, you know, libertarians are opposed to antitrust law primarily because it violates the rights of companies to engage in collusion and price setting, so long as they don't violate other people's property rights. It's only a secondary sort of argument we would come up with, you know, the empirical aspects of it and why antitrust law doesn't make much sense anyway. So I would refer you, number one, to the superb book by Michele Boldrin and Michael Levine called Against Intellectual Monopoly. They're economists and they're very empirical and they give tons of case studies. There's a great chapter on pharmaceutical patents, which people usually hold up as the single clear example of why we need patent law. And they really do a great job just eviscerating the entire argument, showing that empirically there is no evidence that patents actually help the pharmaceutical industry. Now, my perspective would be this. First of all sellers have cost of exclusion to be able to be successful in the market. And a good example that I give that I read in some other papers is the drive-in movie industry, say in the 50s, started out with these big loudspeakers. And of course, one problem with that, there's technical problems with it, but one problem is the free rider problem. So people could park on nearby hills and watch and hear the movie for free. So so they started installing these little speakers, which cost a lot of money to do that. So they came up with a creative cost of exclusion. And there's all businesses face cost of exclusion. You have to have ushers and you have to have a ticket collector and a lock on your door to keep people from coming in and getting the service for free. So when you engage in an entrepreneurial endeavor, you have to use your creativity to try to find a way to make money, given the realistic cost of exclusion. And if the cost of exclusion are too high, don't engage in it. Now, for a sense of perspective, I would also say, imagine the pharmaceutical industry, even if the argument is right that that giving them a patent would help protect them from competition and help them charge monopoly prices for a while and to make greater profits, enabling them to have be able to do research on drugs that might lose. What we have is we have the federal government, which taxes and regulates the hell out of companies and individuals, impoverishing everyone in society. So we're all probably, you know, 100, 10 times, 8 times, we'd be 8, 10 times richer easily if the government would just reduce itself back to, you know, 1921 size. So you have this federal government that taxes companies, imposes pro-union legislation, minimum wage laws, the FDA process itself, which drags things out, costs tons of money, and also prevents some drugs from coming to market that could save people's lives. So some people call it the federal death agency. And taxes these companies, double taxes corporations. And we want the same agency that is just killing these companies to then give them a monopoly privilege to let them make a little bit more money than they otherwise would make to make up for some of the depredations that same agency has done to them. I mean, it just makes no sense. It would make more sense to tell the government to back off and lower taxes rather than to give them a monopoly which can clutter up the market. And not only that, patents, as Kristen has mentioned, are just a complete mess. They don't, and the other party you didn't mention is just the public or competitors. They also don't know how to read these claims. They don't know what to make of them half the time. So they know that they're stepping in a minefield, but they don't really know how to step around it quite often. So that would be my main response to that. Let me make one comment about your trademarks. I also believe trademarks should be abolished for the following reason. The only legitimate function of trademark would be to stop fraud, but you can use fraud law for that. So the problem with trademark law is that, number one, it's the wrong plaintiff, right? If you have a consumer who's confused by a fraudulent use of another mark, the consumer should be the plaintiff, not the owner of the trademark. They're not harmed in a cognizable way. Any more than you're harmed if your customers are, quote, stolen, or your girlfriend is, quote, stolen. You don't have a right to your customer. You don't have a right to his money. He has a right to it. So that's one problem with trademark law. Number two, the wrong plaintiff, which is the owner, is suing quite often when there's not fraud. So, for example, when you buy a knockoff Rolex watch for $20 or a fake Louis Vuitton bag on the docks in Turkey for $17, you're not defrauded. You know it's a fake, and that's why you want it. You want the cheap fake. So the consumer's not defrauded, and the seller's not defrauding anyone, and yet he can still be sued. So that's another problem with trademark law. Not to mention the 1995 addition, the anti-dilution provisions, which are added to trademark law, which permits the owner of the trademark to sue people when there's no consumer confusion whatsoever, just because it might tarnish or dilute the value of their mark, which means you have a property right in value now when property is supposed to be property in the physical integrity of your scarce resources. So trademark law is completely confused, and there's tons of horrible examples of trademark law, too. Trade secret law is problematic in that it, injunctions can be used to enforce it, but other than that, trade secret law is not too bad. So
I'd like to invite the audience to ask questions. Our panel was supposed to end now, but the conveners have told me we have a little time for questions afterwards. So, yes.
If I understand that theory correctly, if the companies use the exact same name, have the pretty close to the same product, right? But what about the factor to be considered from a business perspective, the company that created that trademark? I mean, how does that fit into the whole picture? There may be no confusion because the consumer is sophisticated, and there, from an evidentiary standpoint, I don't know how the court. How does the court come to that conclusion? Are there surveys taken? Are there witnesses testifying in court? But what troubles me about that theory is it disregards the entire concept of intellectual property to the extent that a company goes to the trouble of creating a new trademark. The business is successful. Somebody comes along and copies that, copies everything. And there's got to be some explanation here. Thank you.
So the... let's see. What I think your comment might eventually be directed towards, actually, is the development of anti-dilution law in the U.S. as well as in Europe and other jurisdictions. We say nowadays that even if there is no consumer confusion as to source, still, when one company comes along and uses as a junior user some other company's mark in such a way that doesn't confuse consumers, we still think there's something wrong with it. So what we say is wrong with it is that it dilutes the distinctiveness of the senior company's mark. More generally, I think trademark law has this intuition that there's just some misappropriation taking place. There's just something wrong with this, you know? There's someone reaping where the person has not sown, and the old-fashioned theory of consumer confusion won't allow us to reach that conduct, so we've got to figure out a new way to do it. We've come up with this theory of dilution. Which I'm, you know, suspicious of myself. I think it's an utterly coherent theory for the marketplace in which we live currently. In but that's another story.
Ah, yes.
Given that the term intellectual property doesn't really have a plain meaning, I notice that everybody is still using it. Do you ever think about using something else, and what, and why do you use the term intellectual property when it's so rife with problems and definitely does not have a plain meaning?
It's anti-intellectual.
Well, I sympathize, of course, and I'm afraid to legitimize the legitimize it by using the state's own propaganda, but we have to communicate with each other. And but you know, you and I, we've thought of different alternatives, like pattern privileges or intellectual. What are some of the others? Intellectual property. That's right. That's yours. That's a good one. Intellectual monopoly is another. So I don't know. I don't put too much into the power of words being, you know, talismans that you. I mean, I think you can explain what you're talking about, and it's an accepted term. But maybe you're right. Maybe some of us opponents should try to use other terms when we can.
Sure.
Hi. I have several comments for Mr. Kinsella, but I think I'll save them for after we're done, because frankly, steam's coming out of my ears.
and we also have very little time.
Yeah, no, I understand. But for Professor Beebe, do the trademark cases deal at all with the defendant's intent? Meaning, I'm thinking of something in the paper recently involving Kentucky Fried Chicken, Kennedy Fried Chicken, KFC, and the people behind the Kennedy Fried Chicken openly acknowledged they were trying to, you know, confuse people. KFC.
So yes, certainly the likelihood of consumer confusion test includes as one of its factors the defendant's intent. And as an empirical matter, when a court finds that the defendant has engaged in bad faith intent to confuse consumers, courts almost invariably rule in favor of the plaintiff. I mean, I know the study because I did it, and it shows that this factor is just sort of dispositive. It's dispositive on the copyright side as well in other contexts. But courts consider intent. But don't forget, there's a little wrinkle to this that defendants try to take advantage of, and that is to say, there's nothing wrong with me taking someone else's good idea. Is it a bad faith intent to compete as strongly as I can? Kentucky Fried Chicken had a great idea, and these chicken stands. Can't I open the same chicken stands? So far, so good. Oh, wait, and I want to call them Kennedy Fried Chicken because it sounds a lot like KFC or Kentucky. Then we have a problem with bad faith intent. But this typically, the defendant will make the argument that all the defendant is trying to do is compete effectively with against the plaintiff. So.
Richard.
This is a question for all three of you in somewhat different ways, and it has two parts. First part is, to what extent, when we try to think of intellectual property as the proper intellectual foundation, as some variation on the Lockean theory, labor theory of value, saying, in effect, we can't internalize it in a particular good, as in the examples that he gave, and so what we have to do is to protect the labor by making sure that the outputs by others, in effect, respect it. And secondly, how does that theory apply to a tort which we haven't talked about, but which Barton sort of hinted at, which is the misappropriation tort under the INS case? So I'd like to hear your views on that.
Okay. So actually, I think that the entire theory of labor has confused both economics and political theory. And so it's led to Marxism and Adam Smith's problems. And in the field of law, it's also led to the to intellectual property and defamation law, things like this, and to the confusion about what property is and believing in property rights and the value of things instead of the things themselves. So I think Locke actually made a mistake in his argument. He made an overly metaphorical argument when he said, you own yourself, true enough, if you mean by that you have the right to control who hits your body, and therefore you own your labor. Now, I think that's double counting and a mistake. And then he says, and therefore, because you own your labor, you own things you mix it with, which also doesn't follow, because if you spit in the ocean, you lose your spit. You don't homestead the ocean. But anyway, I think the Locke was right, but he presented the argument wrong. The basic Lockean argument is simply that a person who's a self-owner and mixes his labor with thereby being the first user or appropriator of a scarce resource that was previously unowned, thereby demonstrates a better claim to it than anyone else who, with respect to him, is a latecomer. So you don't even need to talk about labor ownership. To say that you own your labor is just a metaphor that really is double counting, because to own your labor would be like saying you own your action. I mean, your action is what you do with your body. The fact that you own your body gives you the right to perform labor, and then you can use that to do services or things like that. It's similar to what Rothbard pointed out when he pointed out why defamation law, for example, is illegitimate, because it gives you a property right in other people's heads and what they think about you. And also Rothbard pointed out all rights are property rights. And so, for example, when we say a right to free speech, this is another example of double counting. There really is no independent right to free speech. There's only the right to use your property and your body as long as you don't harm anyone else. To say there's a right to free speech would imply that you have the right to speak on someone else's property, but you don't. So if you have your own property and your body, that's sufficient to give you the ability to speak. It's just one of the things you can do with the freedom and the right to own your body. So to be speaking of all these rights as if they're independent rights, but they're not. They're just dependent on your basic natural rights or your human rights, leads to confusion in this area. Of course, the labor theory of value contaminated Adam Smith's thought, which led to Marxism lots of mistakes in that regard, too. So I think labor is just a complete, leads to confusion in this area.
Well, I guess I was raised in a different tradition. I grew up partially in Berkeley, California, and so the Germans assigned to us in high school were different from the Austrians, you know. So I will say that I've always thought that we haven't taken Locke far enough in the sense that we don't respect the degree to which labor, through labor, a person invests his or her species being in the products of her labor, and we've established this legal tradition that assumes people can just alienate away everything that they've made, and it's the source of a lot of misery in a post-industrial economy like ours. So obviously I'm at the complete opposite end, if we must show our cards, and I've always... And I think a lot of intellectual property can be adjusted to take account of the degree to which people should not be forced, we should not allow people to alienate their intellectual labor, the expression of their souls in a marketplace. We should allow attribution rights to continue. Instead of intellectual property, we speak of the right of the author in Europe. They take this very seriously there.
Moral rights
is what we call it here, and it's, the French have a different term for it. So.
Okay. That one.
I'm getting upset on moral rights. can we hear back there?
Professor Kinsella, would you call the so-called intellectual property theft of legitimate property? Because as you explained in your paper, intellectual property violates the homesteadian libertarian principle of, I mean, the legitimate owner is the one who gets the physical property in the first place. Would you call it theft?
Yes. And the reason, imagine a neighborhood with a restrictive covenant. This is a situation where everyone owns their home, but they have signed a restrictive covenant, which basically makes everyone else in the neighborhood a partial co-owner of their house with them, to the extent that they can, say, veto, through certain procedural means, certain uses, right? So my neighbors can veto my painting my house orange, okay, because it would be hideous and reduce value in the neighborhood, et cetera. But I entered into this agreement, so that's a type of, so a veto right like that is a type of ownership right, a type of co-ownership of my property. Now, this is what copyright and patent holders have. They basically have a state-enforced veto over other people's use of their own bodies and or their property. And when the right is assigned to a copyright or patent holder, they are basically given a partial co-ownership right of my property. And as I said, as long as you don't commit a tort or enter into an agreement with them to do this, then it hasn't been consented to, and it's a type of theft, yes.
So unfortunately, I am told we are out of time. I know there are several people with questions, and I invite you to come up and talk to the panel if they're so willing. And thanks, everybody.